We've also helped secure an Air Canada flight from Spain, as well as Air Transat flights, including two from Honduras and one each from Ecuador, El Salvador, and Guatemala. If you're a Canadian abroad, register with the government now so we can send you updates and contact you. You need to do this if you haven't done it already. Depuis le début de cette crise, on utilise tous les outils à notre disposition pour gérer la situation. On est chanceux, les innovateurs canadiens sont parmi les meilleurs au monde et ils veulent faire partie de la solution. On a investi 275 millions de dollars dans la recherche sur la COVID-19 et le développement des vaccins. La vaccination et les traitements antiviraux sont des options qu'on doit absolument poursuivre. On le voit avec la grippe. Les vaccins empêchent les gens d'être malades, protègent les plus vulnérables et font en sorte que de moins en moins de monde se rende à l'urgence. Aujourd'hui, j'annonce qu'on va investir 192 millions de dollars pour soutenir directement la création et la production de vaccins au Canada. On finance une solution à long terme contre la COVID-19 chez nous. On va signer une entente avec l'entreprise AbCellera de Vancouver pour soutenir leur travail visant à traiter et à prévenir la COVID-19. On travaille aussi avec l'entreprise Medicago de Québec pour produire et tester des vaccins. En même temps, on alloue également des fonds au Vaccine and Infectious Disease Organization de l'Université de la Saskatchewan pour le développement de vaccins et les essais cliniques. Le Canada a besoin de la capacité nécessaire pour produire des traitements en masse le plus rapidement possible. On investit donc aussi dans les installations du Conseil national de recherche de Canada à Montréal. Today, I can announce that we are providing $192 million to directly support vaccine development and production in Canada. We're investing in a long-term solution to COVID-19 right here at home. Our government will be signing an agreement with Vancouver-based AbCellera to support their work on drugs to prevent and treat COVID-19. We're also working with Quebec City-based Medicago for vaccine testing and production. At the same time, we're providing funding for the University of Saskatchewan's Vaccine and Infectious Disease Organization for development and clinical trials. Once there are promising options, Canada needs the capacity to mass produce treatments as quickly as possible. That's why we're investing in the National Research Council of Canada's facility in Montreal to prepare for the rollout. These are critical steps forward, but we have to remember that vaccines won't be ready overnight. They will take months to develop and test. So while that's happening, we need to work to mitigate the impacts of this virus. And luckily, we have the tools we need right here at home. Blue Dot in Toronto was among the first in the world to identify the spread of COVID-19 coming in 9 days ahead of the World Health Organization's public warning. We've signed a contract to use this Canadian software to model the disease. It will help us track and therefore slow the spread. Minister Baines has also sent a call to action to every university, college, polytechnic, and CEGEP in the country. Their labs have the resources and expertise to be part of this fight. We've asked them to identify equipment they've got, like masks and ventilators. At the same time, we're looking at innovative solutions they can be part of, including 3D printing of medical supplies. Many institutions have already stepped up, and many more will do the same. If you need more information, please go to buyandsell.gc.ca. We need all hands on deck. Nous demandons à chaque université, collège, école polytechnique et cégep du pays de nous donner tous les masques et ventilateurs qu'ils ont ou de nous proposer d'autres façons d'aider, par exemple avec une imprimante 3D. Beaucoup d'établissements ont déjà répondu à l'appel et beaucoup d'autres pensent à le faire. Pour plus de renseignements, consultez le site achatetvente.gc.ca. On a tous un rôle à jouer dans la lutte contre la COVID-19. Même si vous n'êtes pas un ambulancier ou un chercheur, vous pouvez sauver des vies. en restant à la maison le plus possible, en maintenant une distance d'au moins 2 mètres avec les autres si vous devez sortir, vous pouvez faire toute la différence. C'est comme ça qu'on peut se protéger et protéger nos infirmières, nos médecins et nos professionnels de la santé qui prennent soin de ceux qui en ont besoin. Il faut suivre les recommandations de nos agences de santé publique, il faut leur faire confiance et il faut les écouter. Hier, j'ai eu un moment où j'ai parlé aux enfants directement. Aujourd'hui, j'ai une pensée pour nos aînés. On a tous des êtres chers qui sont chez eux, qui sont très vulnérables. Alors, appelez-leur et dites-leur que vous les aimez. Je pense moi-même à mon beau-père, le papa de Sophie, Jean, qui suit des traitements pour le cancer depuis quelques mois. Alors, on ne le voyait pas souvent, mais aujourd'hui, c'est sa fête. Joyeux anniversaire, Jean-Jean. Il a 77 ans aujourd'hui. Pensons à nos aînés, pensons à nos êtres chers et faisons tout ce qu'on peut pour les garder en sécurité. C'est comme ça qu'on va freiner la COVID-19. Merci de faire votre part et sachez que notre gouvernement va continuer de travailler jour et nuit pour vous appuyer. Ensemble, on va s'en sortir. Merci.
Hi, Mr. Prime Minister. It's Annie Bergeron-Oliver with CTV National News. You said that a vaccine will take months despite funding and assistance that's being announced today and that the government has already put in place. What immediate and specific actions is the federal government doing to increase testing capabilities and to reduce the testing backlogs that people are facing right across the country?
As we said on vaccines, we have moved forward on investing in a number of companies to accelerate their movement towards clinical trials and eventual production of a vaccine. In the meantime, we are increasing our testing capacity every single day. Many companies in Canada are increasing their production. We're working with labs across the country to accelerate the arrival of testing results as well. We recognize that there is a significant load on the system. We are looking at technological and concrete solutions that will accelerate this process because we recognize that mass testing is a key part of the path forward. Par rapport au vaccin, on va aider les compagnies qui s'approchent des phases cliniques pour pouvoir accélérer leur travail, pour avoir des résultats plus rapidement. Mais ça, évidemment, ça va prendre plusieurs mois. Pour l'instant, on sait que les tests de dépistage sont essentiels. On est en train d'investir pour accélérer la production et la disponibilité des tests, mais on travaille aussi pour accélérer le processus d'attente pour les résultats. Il y a une charge énorme dans le système, mais nous pouvons et nous devons en faire plus parce qu'on sait que les tests font partie intégrale de comment on va freiner et empêcher que la COVID-19 se répande encore plus.
There are a lot of people who are sitting at home right now watching this press conference who cannot afford to continue paying their rent or for themselves or for their businesses. Why hasn't your government done more to specifically help renters?
Yeah. We know that there are significant pressures on Canadians right across the country who are facing bills coming in, who are facing pressures on caring for their families. That is why we are working extremely quickly to get money out the door into the pockets of Canadians during this extraordinary time. We recognize there are hundreds of thousands of Canadians out there who are applying for EI benefits online. What we're working through, including with the step of recalling Parliament tomorrow, is a legislative package that will allow us to move forward even quicker on getting money into the pockets of Canadians who need it right across the country.
Bonjour, M. Trudeau, Christian Noël de Radio-Canada. Vous avez mentionné les Jeux Olympiques tout à l'heure. Votre message aux Canadiens, aux athlètes, mais aussi au comité organisateur, est-ce que c'est prudent à ce moment-ci d'avoir un événement international de ce niveau-là qui a toujours l'air d'aller de l'avant?
OK. Je sais qu'il y a énormément de préoccupations par rapport à tout rassemblement international. Nous reconnaissons que le premier ministre Abe du Japon est très conscient de ces défis. Nous avons pris la décision, le comité olympique canadien a pris la décision qu'il n'irait pas cet été et ils ont annoncé ça hier. Mais j'encourage tout le monde qui pense à avoir des rassemblements de milliers de gens, de ne pas les tenir. C'est important, pas juste au Canada, mais à travers le monde, que les gens restent chez eux.
Et si on regarde ce qui se passe ici au Canada, vous avez mentionné ce qu'on voit sur Internet, les gens qui ont l'air de ne pas se soucier du virus, de se sentir invincibles. J'aimerais savoir à quel point est-ce que ça vous choque de voir ça? Et deux, est-ce que ça veut dire que les frontières, entre guillemets, entre les provinces devraient aussi être fermées? Est-ce que vous allez en parler avec les premiers ministres?
Bien. Évidemment, on va certainement en parler avec les provinces ce soir. Nous devons de continuer d'être coordonnés, pas juste dans nos approches, mais dans nos communications. Malheureusement, comme on a tous vu, il y a des gens qui se pensent invincibles, qui continuent de sortir dehors. Je comprends, la météo commence à se réchauffer un petit peu, les gens veulent sortir, mais c'est pas le temps. Il faut que les gens gardent leur distance, il faut que les gens restent chez eux le plus possible. Parce que c'est pas juste une question d'être vulnérable soi-même, c'est une question de vulnérabiliser nos aînés, de mettre en danger et à risque ceux qui travaillent dans notre système de santé. Nous avons besoin de suivre les conseils des experts et ces conseils nous disent de rester chez nous et de garder de la distance avec nos voisins.
Morning, Prime Minister Trudeau. Olivia Stefanovic, CBC News. How exactly will your government enforce social distancing? Can you spell out exactly what that will look like?
We are going to be speaking with the premiers this evening and talking about ways we can coordinate. We recognize that many communities, many provinces have declared states of emergency. They have taken measures to close certain public places. There is more that can be done. There is more that needs to be done around messaging, and that's what we're going to be talking about. But every step of the way, if we see that measures aren't being taken up properly, that aren't being followed, we will look at different measures that could be necessary to enforce these rules. We'd rather not, and we know that millions of Canadians are doing their part, but those who are not doing their part are putting at risk everyone else, including the eventual recovery of our economy and the well-being of millions of Canadians. So we're going to continue to look very carefully at what could be next steps as we move forward.
Can you spell out exactly what kind of enforcement measures you're looking at the national level?
I can tell you that we haven't taken anything off the table, from the Emergencies Act to new measures or existing measures under the Quarantine Act. There are significant tools that are at our disposal. But like I said, we are impressing upon Canadians to do this of their own will, to understand that individuals can and must do their part to keep us all safe and to ensure that we come through this in the best way possible.
Should all provinces and territories close their borders?
I will be speaking with the premiers tonight about measures that we can take as a country to move forward, and I look forward to that conversation.
Prime Minister Ryan Templeton with the National Post. I'm wondering, this week will be the end of your 14-day self-isolation. Are you planning to resume a quasi-public schedule? Are you planning to leave the House?
As many people are, I'm listening to the advice of experts. I recognize that there is still a week to go in my self-isolation, and we're going to continue doing that. Those decisions on what next will be taken in the right way, depending on what public health says. But certainly, I am going to make sure that we continue to follow all recommendations of public health officers, particularly around staying at home wherever possible and self-isolation and social distancing, which means keeping 2 meters apart from each other.
In terms of the messaging, you know, we've seen people at beaches, we've seen people out on trails clustered together, we've seen people out at large parties together. Do you think it's just a question of people not getting the message? Because you're talking a lot about messaging today.
I think people need to get the message that this isn't just about them. This is about their neighbors. This is about vulnerable seniors. This is about health workers who are on the front lines trying to keep us all safe. Canadians can and must do their part to keep us all safe. When we see images of people out enjoying the sunshine in large groups, that is extremely concerning because they are not just putting themselves at risk, they are putting everyone else at risk. We need to slow and stop the spread of this virus if we are going to come through this strongly as a country without losing too many of our loved ones. Every single Canadian has a responsibility to engage in keeping their distance, in staying home whatever possible, and ensuring that those who have to go out for essential services and to keep us healthy and alive and fed are not at risk themselves. Je pense que c'est frustrant pour beaucoup des Canadiens qui sont chez eux de voir que d'autres gens ne suivent pas les protocoles ou les recommandations. Et c'est frustrant pour beaucoup de gens qui voient qu'il y a des gens qui suivent pas. I think it's frustrating for a lot of people who are listening to medical advice and staying home for their safety to watch other people out there putting not just themselves at risk, but everyone who is staying home at risk as well.
Merci beaucoup. On va maintenant passer à aux questions par téléphone. Modérateur, c'est à vous.
Thank you. Merci. The first question is from Brian Lilly of the Toronto Sun. La première question est de Brian Lilly du Toronto Sun. La parole est à vous. Please go ahead, sir. Your line is open.
Prime Minister, I'm wondering if you can tell us, you keep being asked about the Emergencies Act and you seem hesitant. Why are you hesitant and what extra powers would the Emergencies Act or Quarantine Act give you that you currently don't have?
The Quarantine Act is already in place, and it gives us significant tools. One of the key elements of the Emergencies Act is that it is an override over the provinces. It takes powers that are normally only in the hands of provinces or even municipalities and puts them at the federal level. That's why we've been working closely and coordinating, watching closely as provinces have invoked their Emergencies Act, which has been an important step in fighting the spread of this virus. It's also why we will certainly be talking about the Federal Emergencies Act at the Premier's meeting this evening to make sure that we all understand what tools each different order of government has and where we might need to do more.
Thank you. Merci. La question suivante est de Hélène Buzetti, Le Devoir. The next question is from Hélène Buzetti, Le Devoir. Please go ahead. La parole est à vous.
Oui, Monsieur Trudeau, justement, dans cet ordre d'idées, je sais que vous allez parler à vos homologues, mais vous avez sûrement des communications déjà. Y a-t-il des provinces qui vous ont demandé d'invoquer la loi sur les mesures d'urgence?
Il n'y a aucune province qui nous a demandé formellement ou officiellement d'invoquer. C'est certain que ça fait partie des discussions, mais comme j'ai dit, puisque une grande partie de la loi sur les mesures d'urgence est de s'approprier des pouvoirs au fédéral qui sont normalement limités au niveau provincial, c'est une conversation que nous devons avoir avec les provinces.
Thank you. Merci. The last question is from Maura Forrest, Politico. La question suivante est de Maura Forrest, Politico. La parole est à vous. Your line is now open. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you, Prime Minister. In the United States, California and New York have enacted lockdown measures at the state level. You're not ready yet to invoke the Emergencies Act, but would you support individual provinces enacting similar measures in Canada?
We know that provinces and cities are looking at what next steps they can take. We, of course, will support them in their decision-making, in the powers that they have, recognizing that many of them, if not all of them, have invoked the Emergencies Act at their provincial level. We will continue to coordinate and make sure that they have the backing of the federal government where necessary. We will continue to monitor closely this situation, to work with experts across Canada and indeed around the world on everything we need to do to keep Canadians safe. But even as we do that, with all the levers of governments and regulations and powers, fundamentally it comes down to citizens making smarter choices, choosing to stay home, choosing to self-isolate, choosing to keep their distance from each other, not going out and putting at risk people who have to be out for essential reasons in our hospitals, in our food supply, in our pharmacies. These are the things that people need to be doing. These are things, unfortunately, that not everyone is doing yet, and it is why it is so important for Canadians to step up and do what they can, not just to keep themselves safe, but to keep their neighbors and the rest of us safe as well. Merci tout le monde.